Hi everyone, welcome to Google Developers Live. My name's Ali and today I'm going to be taking some questions about the Google Drive SDK and going to be talking a bit about the answers. During this process, if you have any burning questions, please feel free to ask it on the YouTube comments or on the Google Plus event, and someone will tell me and we'll try and get that answered live on air for you. So for those of you who don't know, we use Stack Overflow for question and answer support. We're really happy with that. At the moment, it seems that the community is growing and there are a number of contributors who don't work at Google who are actually helping other newer users on how to use the Drive SDK. So we're very happy about that, and thank you to everyone who's answering. That's great that you're part of the community, and that's really our intention with using Stack Overflow, is to be part of the broader programming community. So that's absolutely great. So let's get started. First question. Is the only way to download a file through Google Drive through the download URL that is provided? I have the file ID and would like to make one simple call to download the file. Right now, it looks like you have to make one call to fetch the file metadata and one to actually download the file. Is there any other way? Well, this is absolutely right. The correct way of doing it is to fetch the metadata, to get the download URL, and then to download it. That's always going to be two requests. Now, this is for a couple of reasons. The first one is the download URL doesn't last for very long. This is a measure to make sure that people just can't keep these immortal download URIs around for a long time, because that's not exactly great. So we generate them, we give it to you, and then you can use it over a short space of time. That's the first part. The second part is, although the scheme for these URLs seems predictable and you could probably go about generating it yourself, we strongly recommend you don't do that. So for these two things, we really recommend make the two requests. If you're downloading that many files that it makes a huge difference to make a small GET request beforehand, I'd be really interested to know your use case. So get in touch with us if that really is doing huge network bandwidth that you just don't want to do. Let us know and we'll have a look at that use case. But for now, this is the way to do it. There are other ways of downloading files from Google Drive. If you want to let the user download it in their browser, we have this web content link. That uses a different auth mechanism, and that may be more suitable. If you don't want to download a file and then give it to the user to download, they can download it directly and you will never have to get involved with that. So that's great. You'll only find the URL with the GET request, and then the user can download the file. That's another option for you. So that's that question answered by Claudio. It says pretty much the same thing. Right, next question. It's about our date and time format in the Google Drive API. I'm having an issue with the create date, modify date for the Google Drive API. When I get the data, the time is displayed as, and there's a time stamp there, and they want to know how to convert it to and from this format. Well, that time format we use is RFC 3339, which is kind of not that well supported by some programming languages. PHP doesn't really have a good built-in standard library thing to do it. The Python standard library also doesn't do this without a tiny bit of tweaking. And it's mostly because, I'll use Python as an example. Python's time zone segment on the end of the timestamp comes with a complete part. So if it's 7 hours before Greenwich Mean Time, before UTC, it will say -700, and the format this expects is -7:00. So although this is a RFC timestamp and it's a good one and it's a consistent one and it's what we've been using for a long time, and Atom and everything, so you might have to write yourself a little function to convert that. I've put an example on there in Python, someone else has put an example in PHP, and if you look up RFC 3339, you will find a sample in your programming language. So it's annoying to have to work around, but I'm sure someone's already done that for you. So that's times and dates. And we use the same format for all our fields that have a time or date in them. Great, service account. So the question is, Google Drive changing permissions by service account. They're looking for the best approach for administrators of Google Apps domains to modify the permissions of a Google Drive object owned by other users. Okay, this used to be done by two-legged OAuth. If anyone has used two-legged OAuth, we're now moving away from that, and we've moved to a model that is based on service accounts. Now, we have two different types of service accounts. One of them is owned by a developer console project, and the other one is owned by a Google Apps domain. Now, this question is specifically asking about a Google Apps domain. So if you go to your cPanel and you enable the Drive scope, you can get your service account certificate, and you can actually use that to log in for any of the users on your domain, to authorize for any of the users on your domain. And then really you can perform actions for that user as if you were authorized as them. This is pretty useful, and it pretty much covers the use case in this question. So you would authorize as the user who wants to be able to share the files with other people. Okay, and then you just add the permissions using the permissions.insert method to add the permission for whoever else to read or write or comment, or even you can use this to change the owner of a file. So that's that part. There's a slight mention of Google App Engine service accounts. So Google App Engine service accounts is unfortunately yet another way of doing service accounts. Now, how the application proves that it is who it is App Engine has its own specific service called App Identity. So App Identity says, hi, I am this application, so please authorize me as a service account for this application. Unfortunately, that's currently not supported in the Drive API. We're really working hard to support this, and if I had to guess, I'd say days or weeks this will be working. So that's absolutely brilliant. It's really useful in Python, because the Python App Engine SDK doesn't actually have enough cryptography to do regular service accounts yet. Again, that's something that's coming. So for now, you can use these kind of App Engine App Identity. One proviso is that with App Identity, you will not be able to use the drive.file scope. Now, the drive.file scope does depend very much on who the app is, so that users can authorize files for certain applications, and applications can't read all the files in your drive, just the specific ones. So those features get turned off for App Identity service accounts. But again, that's not exactly a problem, because with App Identity service accounts, the files are owned by the application itself, so the file scope is reasonable depending on your use case. So that's enough about service accounts. Just to let you know, we've covered these two cases, Dev Console service accounts and domain service accounts, and we've created two new tutorials on using them. So please check them out. They're at developers.google.com/drive. They're called service accounts and user impersonation. This is one of the things we really want to get absolutely right. We do appreciate this use case that used to be covered well by two-legged OAuth. So if you have any problems, let us know. We want this to be absolutely right. Okay, next question. Google Drive changes list API, detecting changes at a folder level. Okay, this is a question we get asked quite a lot. The changes feed, just to give you a little summary, is that if you're authorized as a user, you can get a list of, or more like a timeline really, of all the changes that have happened to files in their Google Drive. So it will show this file was modified, this file was created, a certain file was deleted, and it goes in reverse chronological order. Each one of these changes has a unique ID that you can remember. So you can say, I only want changes since that unique ID. This is the changes feed. Really, really useful to prevent having to download a whole user's Google Drive, find out what's changed, and then modify it locally. I'm thinking of use cases like synchronizing applications that you write. So the question here is, can we detect changes at a folder level? Brilliant use case, and I can see why. Unfortunately, we don't support that. We believe that currently the changes feed is small enough, you know, there are only going to be a few hundred maybe at most changes. It's small enough that you can get the whole feed and filter it for the ones that you want in the right folder. So each of the entries in the changes feed will have, as long as it's not a delete, will have a parent ID, for example. And if you look at the parent ID, you can find out which folder it lives in. Now, I appreciate the delete case doesn't actually work here, because, well, we believe very strongly that users own the data. So if they've deleted a file, you shouldn't really be able to find out what the parents for that file were. You shouldn't be able to know what the title for that file was. The user has deleted it and that's gone. We do give you the file ID, but of course, if you haven't got a mapping of file IDs to parents, you don't know where that exists. So I appreciate this use case is not completely covered, but there's not really much we can do. We have to respect the user's privacy and the fact that the user owns the data here. I think that's a reasonable choice. I'm a developer myself, so I would like it the other way, but I do respect the user's choice here. So another question asking about two-legged OAuth for Google Drive from Android. So that's a really interesting question. It doesn't actually work for a number of reasons. One, we don't officially support two-legged OAuth on Google Drive. And two, I'm not sure how you could use that exactly from Android. I guess you could just use it as an installed application on Android. So I'm not sure what the use case is here. Again, Mr. or Mrs. Gautam, I would be really pleased to hear your use case because that sounds kind of interesting. You can use a service account from Android. The other thing you can actually do, which may or may not be suitable for you, but it would cover the use case, is that if you have offline access, if you have an access token and a refresh token, you can essentially keep them forever and use them. Now, I'm assuming this app is not something you want to publish widely, because if you publish a two-legged OAuth token widely, and that's a permanent token, anyone can use that. So really you've given away your whole credentials. So I'm guessing this is an internal app. And if it's an internal app, you can just use a saved standard OAuth 2 token or a saved service account OAuth 2 token that has offline access and that can be refreshed forever. So I'm guessing this is for an internal use case for someone rather than an external app. If it is an external app, please do not put raw tokens in your APK or in fact in anything, even if it's compiled, obfuscated. This stuff is reasonably straightforward to reverse engineer. So please don't do that. Fingers crossed that is an internal use case here. So we've done a few there. Should we check if there are any other questions? I'm just going to check quickly if there are any other questions from people. Nope, not there. Okay, so they'll let us know if there is. Great. So next question, Google Drive SDK image metadata. Recently we launched the feature to add EXIF data. If you don't know what EXIF data is for images, when your camera, your flashy camera takes a photograph, it stores some information in there. Even cameras on phones do this, so the camera make, the camera model, the aperture, the exposure, the focal length, these kind of things are all stored in the image as some extra metadata so that other applications can look at them, photo applications, photo organizing, photo editing. We recently, last week, exposed this data because we index it for Google Drive. It's very useful, lots of photos in Google Drive. Perfect use case if you're a photographer, store your photos there and they will never be lost. This question is asking for some missing features, missing fields. So actually focal distance is one that we're missing. Focal distance, metering mode, sensor type. And there are some IPTC metadata keywords that are missing. Perfect example. Thank you for bringing this up. I hope this person's writing a awesome file image gallery kind of application for Drive, because if they are, I really want to use it myself because I've got lots of photos there. So they're just asking for this extra data. And there's a perfect use of Stack Overflow. Thank you for telling us this. We're looking to get these features added as soon as possible so your apps can work. Okay. Yes, please someone write a photo editing app, photo management gallery app. I'm desperate to use it. Okay, let's do one more, shall we?
We do have a question on YouTube.
Oh, do we?
One of them says, is there a way to get files from the Google Drive and read it in using Java?
Yes, the answer is absolutely yes. When you say get files, I guess you mean download files or upload files? Downloading files. Okay, great. So yes, absolutely. If you go to a URL that I will put in the YouTube comment, it's actually, I'll tell you what it is in the YouTube comment. but we have a Java snippet for doing exactly that. You should be able to take the snippet, copy it, paste it into your application, and everything should work. Okay, it's two steps. One, you get the download URL, and then you perform a download using the raw underlying HTTP library with the added authorization header. But we show you how to do that, copy and paste it. Java's not special. We also have identical sample for Python, Go, PHP, JavaScript, Ruby, .NET, and any language you want there, please let us know. We'll look to see to add it. So yes, absolutely. We love Java developers. You're very important to us.
So there's another question via Google Plus Events asking about 2LOA scope for the Drive API. I'm wondering if we can expect a 2LOA scope for the Drive API so they can write apps, marketplace apps that take advantage of it.
So this is an unsupported feature at the moment, but actually 2LO scoped tokens for Google Documents List API do currently work against the Drive API. So I'm not exactly overly enamored with that, because we're trying to deprecate OAuth 1. Well, we have deprecated it, but we're trying to get rid of all the use cases. Now, we specifically allowed this for the case where someone already has a token for the Documents List API. They want to start using the Drive API, and they don't want users to reauthorize. We wanted to smooth that user experience for your apps. So right now, you can get a Documents List API scope token from your cPanel used with two-legged OAuth with the Drive API. Unsupported, may go away, but if that covers your use case for now, please use it. Please look to using regular service accounts. I think you can, even though you're in the apps marketplace, but we don't want to make that harder for you right now to migrate across. So first I'd say migrate using the token, and then we'll look at fixing that.
And there's one more question from Joshua Owen, who says he's developing a Hangout app that makes use of the Google Drive integration via Picker object to obtain the file ID.
Right.
He says he can temporarily share images he owns to Hangout participants using permission methods, but this obviously won't work for things that are shared to him. Is the best way to accomplish this to copy the file to the local user drive and then share out to the Hangout participants?
Yes. So if you don't have enough authority to add permissions to the user, or if you really don't want to do that, you know, it's potentially not polite if someone shares something with you and then you share it on. Yes, copying it to your own drive and then sharing it out from there kind of makes sense, but that's the best way to do it. You can, if you have permission to add other, I think it's called the writers can invite field. So if you have that one set, then you can still invite other people to do that. But otherwise, yes, copying it is the best way. But that's a cool app. I'd love to know about that. When you launch, please just let us know, because, obviously we're always into integrations between two different Google products, but I think the collaborative nature of Hangouts and the collaborative nature of the Drive editors, there's really a lot of integration points there. So please let us know. We're really keen to see that. Any more questions? No? Okay, brilliant. Thank you very much for tuning in. Please keep asking your questions, and please telling us how we can improve. That's really useful for us. Thank you very much. My name's Ali. Take care. Bye-bye.